Welcome to the Flower Lounge, a place for conversations with wildly creative people and a little plant-loving wisdom to help you experience life in full bloom. I'm Katie Hess, flower alchemist and founder of LOTUSWEI, and I believe in a world where we're all living at our personal edge. Welcome to the Flower Lounge Podcast. I'm beyond excited for today's guest. I have been watching her from afar on Instagram and all her adventures through nature, collecting spring water and watching her dog run through the forest and the breeze come through the doors, come through the windows as you drive your car on what look like these weekly amazing road trips. And right now I have Dr. Melissa Sell with us, and she specializes in new Germanic medicine, and I cannot wait to get into this conversation. I know you guys are going to be super excited about learning everything that Melissa has to offer. Do you want to talk about just sort of like give us the snapshot of how you got to where you are today?
Sure. Thank you so much for having me. I'm like really excited to be talking with you, and I love your work. And this I just think is going to be a very wonderful communion. But yes, my work. So I am a chiropractor, and right out of high school, I started working at a chiropractic office, and it just like changed my world. And I got so into health and nutrition and exercise and all things lifestyle. And I graduated chiropractic school in Atlanta at Life University 2012. And I started practicing right away, and I loved it. I'm just so passionate about helping people change their life and their health and their food and like all the things. And through my work, I started seeing, you know, patterns within myself, patterns within my patients, seeing that behavior changes weren't everything. So changing the food, getting, you know, toxins out of your products, getting adjusted, doing all of these things were awesome, incredible. But there was something I just felt was missing within, you know, what I was teaching, missing within myself. I, you know, still dealt with a lot of anxiety on like every Sunday night, like before I'd go into the office for the week, like around 1 o'clock on Sunday afternoon, I'd start getting like antsy and anxious about like all the things I hadn't gotten done and all the things ahead. And, you know, I had relationship issues. And so I started, there was stuff going on. there was a missing piece. And through working with my partner and things that we discovered, we started meditating, we started doing like self-inquiry and looking at what's going on behind the scenes. What are, you know, how do I create my perception of reality? And so we started going off in a different direction with our practice. So instead of kind of opening a traditional chiropractic office where we did all health lifestyle stuff, we started teaching people about the mind. We started first understanding it and studying it for ourselves, and then working with our patients. And I started seeing, you know, how emotional issues and things going on behind the scenes were, you know, conducting so much of what was going on in a person's experience, and they had no idea. And I had no idea. And so once it came to light to me, I was like, oh, this is definitely what I want to do with people. And so we started doing that even before I found the 5 biological laws in Germanic New Medicine, which was early 2017. And I was listening to a podcast about magnesium supplementation because I was doing a workshop on it. And Dr. Carolyn Dean, who wrote the Magnesium Miracle book, she mentioned it. Just so the person who was interviewing her just randomly asked her something about cancer. And she mentioned Germanic New Medicine. And I was like, hold the phone. What is this? I've never heard of this before. And I mean, immediately it just, boom, it just resonated. I was like, but of course, you know, you hear Dr. Hammer's story, which if you're not familiar, he lost his son in a very tragic way in 1979. And a few months after his son died, he discovered he had testicular cancer. And he was like, you know, there is a connection here. You know, there's no history of cancer in my family. I had a very dramatic, traumatic loss of my son. And so he went with that idea. And, you know, he was a medical doctor and worked in an oncology unit. And so he started talking to people. And so he not only found that everyone who had some type of cancer had a dramatic, traumatic, shocking event occur in their life, but that it was specific. It wasn't just general stress, because, you know, psychosomatic connection between emotions and health has been known or speculated about for a very long time, but he found very specific patterns of the types of cancer. So why breast cancer? Why thyroid? Why prostate? Why, you know, why digestive cancer? Why? this. And he found that it is a very specific pattern, and that our biology is embedded with this innate, brilliant wisdom that developed over the years of human evolution and development, that we have inborn biological significant programs. And these programs are intentional, and they are deliberate, and they are responses to trauma. They are responses to conflict shock. So something catches you off guard. And as an organism, you know, the number one thing is survival. And so your body has these survival programs built into it. And so all the things that we consider disease, for years I thought, well, it was a breakdown. It was, you know, a dysfunction in the immune system. It was an insult. It was a, you know, something that's gone wrong, and the body is now messing up, or it's attacking itself, or it's confused, and now it's doing something wrong, and we have to, you know, either holistically kind of clean up things so our body can start functioning better, or medically we need to remove things. We need to do some type of intervention to get the body back on track, because, you know, this body doesn't know what it's doing. And the reason that GNM just resonated so much with me was my background in chiropractic, which is very rooted in a deep, deep philosophy, innate wisdom, innate intelligence within the body, that the body knows what it's doing. And that's something that, you know, I had a very profound, almost awakening experience while reading, they're called the Green Books, written by BJ and Dee Dee Palmer, mostly BJ Palmer, who was like the son of the guy who, you know, developed and invented chiropractic, basically. And like, just this wisdom, like, more than we could ever understand. Like, the body is the greatest chemist. The body is, it built itself from scratch. And it's like, who am I, this human? Who are these humans with these minds trying to say, oh, the body needs this, the body doesn't need this, we can do this and that to the body? And it's like, oh, that is, it just is, our minds pale in comparison to the wisdom that's in the body. And what Dr. Hammer found in this chart that you probably can't see in a podcast, but Dr. Hammer has this ginormous chart of all of the organs, all of the different embryological germ layers, and this wisdom of understanding how the body functions. When you have a symptom, when something seems to be going awry in your body, a rash, a tumor, a pimple, any type of tissue change within your body that you're like, this is not, you know, normal, there's a reason that it's happening. And by understanding and interpreting the language of the body, you can start seeing, oh, this was an adaptive mechanism. This isn't something wrong in my body. This is something profoundly right. And my understanding of that is paramount to me being healthy in the world and understanding what my body is doing and how it's responding to my stresses, to my traumas, to my shocks.
So do you want to get into the actual five biological laws and how that relates to the conflicts?
Yeah, we could do that. So the five biological laws, Dr. Hammer discovered kind of in parts and pieces, and he had kind of interesting dreams where his son visited him and was like, yeah, you're on the right track, which is, I think, super cool. So the first biological law is the connection between the psyche, brain, and organ. And so this is your psyche, your brain, and your organs are not separate. It's all one thing. It's all happening at once, but we talk about it in separate chunks to make it more understandable. So, you know, your nervous system, your body, it's like constantly detecting signals from your environment at all times. Your body's like, what's going on? Are we safe? Is everything okay? You know, like, what do we need to do? Even just right now, how hot or cool is the room? What needs to happen? Like, your body is constantly calibrating and shifting and changing to adapt to your environment so that you can be alive. And so again, the mechanisms that are necessary for life to even exist are beyond comprehension. And so your nervous system is constantly trying to maintain the state of homeostasis. And so when you are caught off guard, when something happens, either something external, you know, there's some kind of predator, a mountain lion is running after you, there are immediate changes. We all know this, the fight or flight, when you're driving down the highway and you see a cop car and you're like, oh, was I going too fast? And all of the physiological changes that happen in that instant. So this is kind of going beyond that. So beyond just the general sympathetic activity, fight or flight, there are very specific things that take place based upon the uniqueness of you. And this is another thing that I just find so phenomenal about this work, is that it helps to explain why different people have different issues. And it has to do with the fact that we're all very unique, special individuals who have unique histories. And the way that we perceive a shocking trauma is different from the way another person perceives it. So based on your unique, you know, your personal history, so the things that you've experienced from the time you were conceived, you know, we have experience in the womb. You know, a lot of people, they are like, well, you know, how could a child who be born with these issues, how can it not be genetic? It's like that child was having an experience from the moment it was conceived. And so the ultrasounds and the interventions and the fears that the mother went through and her insecurities, like all of that, you're bathed in when you are in the womb. And so all of that personal history is your nervous system's learning. It's like, what's safe, what's not safe. You know, we heard this noise and we got scared, you know, like maybe there's a connection, or this, you know, we smelled something and there was a day. So maybe next time when we smell something, we need to be prepared. And so this is how things like allergies form, is that you have a shocking trauma when you're exposed to a food or a scent or a substance. And so now your body flags that. It's like, oh, watch out for that thing. And it activates a biological program. So psyche, brain, organs, something happens, your nervous system detects a danger. Immediately at that moment, there is an impact in the brain, which is, this is a whole nother level of super coolness about GNM, is that Dr. Homer, he found that in the brain, you can actually have a CT scan of your brain and it reveals the traumas and the shocks that you've had, because there are measurable impacts in certain brain regions that are correlated to specific organs within the body. And so, like, I think of it kind of like a button. Something happens in your environment, your psyche makes this split second decision about, okay, this is the nature of this conflict. This is the nature of this thing you just experienced. These are the tissues that we can adapt and step in to help you to resolve this conflict. So an example would be a death fright conflict. Something happens. All of a sudden, you are scared for your life. Your body, you know, you perceive it. Body presses the button, and it is the endodermal tissue of the lungs, and that button starts, and there is adaptation, which is proliferation. So another really cool thing, and this is more within the third biological law, is understanding like each tissue type behaves differently. You know, so the tissue type that your lung alveoli is made out of is different than the tissue of your external lips, you know, and so these tissue types, they do different things. They adapt in different ways depending on, you know, the tissue that's involved. And so for the lung tissue, there's a proliferation. So that's cell increase when you're in conflict. And the purpose of the cellular increase is so that you have more lung alveoli, so you can absorb more oxygen from your each breath. You can get more oxygen into the blood, which again, it's a survival mechanism. Very important for us to have these survival mechanisms, because you don't even know what, like, the smallest edge that could give you in surviving a situation. A great example, another wonderful example, and it happened not that long ago to me, where I was eating. Have you ever eaten something and you're like, either you didn't chew properly or it wasn't properly hydrated, and you're like, I'm kind of choking right now. Like, I don't know if I could swallow this all the way down. There is this moment of panic. There's this moment of is this going down? Is this coming up? And your body, again, you're not on your own, is what is such a cool thing, is your body's like, I can help you, either by eroding, widening the surface mucosa of your esophagus to make the space wider for things to either go down or come up, or it could proliferate the saliva glands in your throat so that you can produce and pump out more saliva to help salivate that chunk, that morsel that's not going down. And it's like, whoa, my body, it knows what it's doing. And so after something like that happens, you'll go through a repair phase where, you know, the tissue that was either eroded or the tissue that was built up, your body wants to put you back to normal. And the way that it does that is by repairing the tissue, which means I've got a sore throat, I feel like I've got strep throat, I've got a scratchy voice, or you've got, you know, kind of pus in the back of your throat on your glands. And it's like the body's either helping restore tissue or helping break down the tissue that was adapted during the conflict. And so it's like this whole complex, intricate, beautiful, orchestrated adaptation that's taking place in the body. And what we think is sickness. Oh, we think a germ got into the throat and now it's taking over and now I got to kill it and I got to do all this stuff. And when you start to recognize and respect like the brilliance that is at play when there are tissue changes within your body, it's just like mind blowing.
Yeah. And instantly too fast, right? It sounds like the body is, it's like this, the way you're describing it, it's like this, the capacity and the complexity of the multi-channel awareness activity happening all at the same time.
Yeah. The immediacy is incredible. And there have actually been studies done where it's even before it's at the level of your consciousness. And this is something that's really unique and interesting and a relevant point of distinction within GNM is Dr. Homer is very clear about the fact that these programs, these are biological programs. It is not psychological. It is biological, meaning that it is like it's beyond just your cognitive capacity. It is so innate and so embedded that, you know, it bypasses your psychology in a sense. And so when you understand, but your psychology can intervene and you can develop this ability to become calm in situations. This is why things like, you know, like heart rate variability and your ability to calm down following a shocking event, your ability to recognize, ooh, I'm conflicted. Like my hands are cold, my heart's racing, my mind is going, a million miles a minute. I am conflicted. I am not feeling safe. And you start noticing what message is this sending to my body? Is my body feeling like, oh, she's good, all is well? Or is my body like, she's not good, we need to help her. She cannot psychologically, you know, she can't handle what's happening. And so that's when the body steps in. And so that's where, you know, we do have the capacity to expand our ability to recognize conflict, to resolve conflict, to give the body signals that, you know, I am safe, all is well, you know, and that we don't have to adapt any longer. And so that's really in like the work that I do with people is in helping to boost that capacity for feeling strong in your environment, feeling, you know, not feeling vulnerable, because feeling vulnerable, feeling weak, feeling like a victim. Again, if you are feeling like a victim of anything, there is a predator, there's something out to get you. And so by shifting something even like a victim mentality, you can downgrade and even resolve and prevent conflicts by feeling more self-confident. And so there's so much tied into this.
It's like, it solidifies a million times over the belief that I have that the way to change the world is inside out. It's like, that is the only way.
100%. It is the only way. And it's through the unique individual. It's like, it's respecting yourself. It's respecting your personal history, your organismic history, your ancestral history. You know, you have to look at all of these things. Your ancestors like survived so much for you to be here. And each ancestor, you know, all the way back, there's been layers of embedded intelligence. And it's like, my body is doing this thing for a purpose. And that's like just the biggest thing to understand is the intentionality of it. And the not that this is not a mistake. Your body is not screwing up.
Well, if you look at, I mean, all you have to do, right, is think about the miraculous sort of alien-like nature of getting pregnant and having a baby. I mean, right. Like what the heck is happening there? Like, yeah, we can get down to everything on a biological level, but when you just like macro, like it's crazy. It's like an alien, right? Something growing inside someone else's body and then it comes out. I mean, it's insane. Like it's nuts. It's mind blowing. And if we're as human beings capable of such beauty and such miraculous intelligence and wisdom and knowing, then what would make us even question that every single other phenomenon that's occurring in the body, even when we're sick, isn't also a miracle in some way, yeah. Right?
Oh yeah. And it, you know, I think ego does come in big time where we think that we know better, you know, and like, and this is the thing about if we want to get into talking about mainstream stuff and what's going on in the world, I do think it is born out of like extreme arrogance to think that I can look at a snapshot of something underneath a microscope and say, I know exactly what this is and what this is causing and what this is doing and what we need to do to fix it. And it's like, do you really though? Do you really know because you looked at something underneath a microscope, do you know the way in which this fits into the big picture of human physiology? You know, and yes, we've discovered really cool things. And yes, we have, you know, a pretty good idea of how we think some things work. But as soon as you say, I know this is what's happening, this is what we need to do to fix it, this is what every single, you know, being on the planet needs to do in order to be okay or safe, it's like, You need to check yourself, because there is like some ego, some arrogance, some, you know, and it's a disrespect for this body that, like, again, built itself from scratch, that created all of these organs, is keeping them functioning. More like chemical reactions are going on in the body in a single cell in a single second than you could even comprehend, that you could write in a million books in a million years. Come on. Like, who do you think you are?
That's kind of
how I feel about it.
Well, we can't even, like, if we're putting so much stake in our minds, and awareness is a good thing, but we can't even be aware of every breath we have.
Nope.
In a day. Or like every time we be aware of every time we blink our eyes, or every heartbeat. Until we get to that point, I think we have a long way to go.
Precisely. Yeah. And just looking at all that goes on. I mean, that's a great meditation. Just to like, think about all that is going right in your body. You know, we zoom in on all the things going wrong. Think about all that is going right for you to be here having an experience. There is a miraculous mystery taking place inside of you every moment of every single day of your existence. And so a little bit of, you know, reverence, I think, for that, and respect, and learning from the body and learning from nature, not trying to supersede nature, not trying to override nature, learning from it, you know. And that is this beautiful respect and understanding that your body has embedded within it such deep, brilliant wisdom. And so learning to work with it rather than working against it, understanding the language of your body, understanding that, you know, when you are boiling with anger, even justified anger at someone else, that anger, it is sending a message to your body, you know, and it may cause you to have some physiological adaptations that don't feel good. You know, you could have issues with your, if it's a territorial anger, you could have issues with your gallbladder, issues with your stomach, issues with your, you know, your pancreatic ducts. Your body is adapting to that. And so it doesn't matter how justified you feel in this rage or in this anger. It could be 100%, you know, everybody in the world would say, yes, you're justified in that. But it's like, is that the message I want to send to my body? You know, like, is there a different way that I could process or perceive this situation? You know, like, not again, it's not forgiveness for the sake of that person or whatever it is that you're mad about. It's for your own sake. It's for not giving the signal to your body that you're in danger, that adaptation needs to take place. And in realizing that, we can start navigating different in the world. You know, we start interacting differently in the world. We start treating children differently. We start realizing that, like, trauma can happen so early and can, you know, set up a precedent for, like, a little baby for conflict activity, for tissue adaptation, for this not feeling safe. And when we start to recognize that within each other, I think we will interact in such different ways.
What are some of the most common, you know, conflicts or traumas or things that you see that play out in people's physical landscape like that?
Self-devaluation is a huge one, you know, and that has to do with your connective tissues of your body. So, you know, muscles, ligaments, lymph nodes, bones. And when you are devaluing yourself, when you don't feel good enough, when you feel broken, when you feel weak, when you feel ugly, when you dislike, you know, things about yourself, you don't feel enough. Your body gets the message, I am not enough. I'm not strong enough, good enough, smart enough, pretty enough. And, you know, the body, I'm not supported. I can't perform physically. You know, your body, it's constantly, again, it's hearing you. It's like, oh, not enough. Okay. We can make you stronger. And so that's the biological program and the biological purpose. There is cellular erosion during conflict activity. And then when you resolve the conflict, the body goes to work, making your lymph node, your bone, your muscle more robust, making it stronger, making it bigger, making it more able, more up to the task that it perceived you weren't up to the task. And so self-devaluation is huge because, you know, just with, comparing ourselves to other people, huge. We get this message early in life an example, even again, in the womb, someone shared with me a story of that when the mother was pregnant, she was in like a life and death kind of situation, like gun to her head kind of situation. And there was this terrified, and the baby was born with clubbed feet, you know? And so it's like, okay, so why would a baby be born with clubbed feet where the ligaments aren't, the feet aren't straight, they're bowed in. And it's like, okay, so that's a weakness. That is a lack of strength within the ankles and the feet. And so that infant, that fetus had the experience of, I need to run away. I'm not enough. I need to be better. I need to be able to get away from this situation. And so being born with something like that, it's like, wow, how interesting that this child had this experience and this pattern was set up of, I need to be stronger. I need to be physically capable of running away and getting away from this situation. And the body adapted in an attempt to do that. And that's the interesting thing too, about a lot of the adaptations. It's like, well, is that really helping? It's like, okay, well, have a little, again, perspective, zoom out to a time and place where this would have been an advantageous thing in nature. And so a lot of the biological programs are like, well, that doesn't make any sense now, but it's not about now. It's about respecting where you came from. And it's about knowing your history.
Anything else that you want to add, like in terms of besides, because I was looking at your website and there's like a million, there's not a million, but like at least 20 or 25, right? Abandonment.
That's anger. Another big one.
Feeling attacked, adrenal, it just seems like death and indigestion. Like what are you seeing a lot of today besides the first one, which sounds really common?
Yeah. So self-devaluation is big. Water retention conflicts are very interesting. They have to do with isolation, abandonment, refugee existence. And so this one is super interesting. It is this fish out of water type of conflict in your body. When it's feeling isolated, when it's feeling abandoned, all alone, like it's got no safe home, you retain water. You hold on to water. And this, again, kind of goes back to aquatic beginnings of, it's very important for an aquatic organism to have water. If you are washed up on the land, you need water to survive. And so when you're feeling, kicked out, and this could be a teenager feeling kicked out of her social circle, feeling abandoned, not getting called, like FOMO, they didn't call me, they don't want to hang out with me. And, you're feeling this sense of rejection, isolation, or abandonment. Your body's like, okay, I have a plan for that. And that is to close off the kidney collecting tubules and hold on to water. And this water retention, can show up. If you have another area of your body that's in healing, when you're holding on to water, the healing gets much more intense. The pain, the swelling is much more intense. You can hold on to water in the form of fat, because like your fat cells can hold a bunch of water. And so if you have very stubborn weight that isn't responding to exercise and nutrition, it's like, could I be retaining water and holding on to this? Financial worries are another thing that can cause you to retain water. This happened to me. I love when stuff happens to me after learning GNM, like anytime any thing would happen, I'm like, oh, this is great. And, it was a couple of years ago and it was a financial thing, something with my taxes or something. And I was like stressed about this money issue. And I noticed, there was like a little bit of a weight around my midsection. And after I resolved it, and this is what'll happen, at night, when you have night sweats are a good indication that your body is in the process of breaking down tissue that was built up during the conflict active phase. So again, it's certain tissue types respond with this type of response with the tubercular bacteria that comes in and basically eats up the tumor or the cells that were proliferated, which is the fourth biological law, which has to do with bacteria and fungus and what we're calling viruses. It's basically like they come in, they are the microsurgeons. So when you resolve a conflict where tissue was built up during the conflict active phase, how does the body get rid of that? How does the body break down a tumor? It uses bacteria, and you look and it uses fungus. Look out in the forest. How does a dead tree, become dirt? Bacteria and fungus come in and break it down. I mean, they are our helpers. They are the microsurgeons. They come in. And so I experienced, I resolved this financial worry and, I was up all night sweating and going to the bathroom and urinating a lot. And then the next day I felt like I lost 5 pounds because I peed it all out because I was holding on to the water. because I was worried about this thing because it was financial, which was like existence, feeling like, oh, am I going to be okay? And once I was okay, my body got that signal, relaxation, breakdown, night sweats, and the program was over.
That's so interesting. I'm thinking about like the retreats that we do in the fall in Costa Rica, or like any time that you go on vacation or you take a little time off and you feel like your body really gets a chance to reset. It kind of always seems like you have to pee more often and like things are moving in a different way than when you're in your normal life where they're a little more stuck. So let's say someone had both of those conflicts going on. Going back to the self-devaluation, could that lead to like painful joints or weak, yes, stiff joints?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, depending on the nature of the conflict. So if you're having a physical performance self-devaluation where, you know, you are not doing, you're doing some type of athletic feat and you're just like, oh, you know, I've got this knee, or you had an injury. Injuries, like if you had an injury in the past and you kind of have the bad knee mentality, it's like, oh, I don't have a good, you know, this knee is bad. You give the signal to your body and you kind of have this ongoing physical performance self-devaluation. Or low back pain, if you're feeling unsupported, there is renovation happening of your low back. Now, this is big. So this kind of actually gets us into the second biological law. And so when you are in the conflict, there's this adaptation, and this is a state of heightened sympathetic activity. So this is like, I'm unsupported. I don't have anyone to help me. No one is here for me. I'm all on my own. You know, this is the self-devaluation. I'm not, you know, I can't handle this on my own. And your lumbar region, and depending, it's a depth thing too. So the depth of the conflict determines the depth, the tissue that is involved. So like the very severe conflicts are going to affect like the bones. The more superficial can affect the lymphatic or even the fat tissue. And so your body begins adapting that tissue. And then once you resolve it, that is when pain happens. So when you're in conflict, there's adaptation, you know, your body's just like, let's resolve this conflict as soon as possible. Then once you resolve it, once you're like, oh, you know, you got the help that you needed, or realized I can do this, you kind of, you know, fortify yourself internally and you resolve this conflict. It's when the conflict resolution happens that you shift into, you know, you go from a state of heightened sympathetic activity to this state of parasympathetic activity. And that's when you feel fatigued, exhausted, no energy, in pain, you have a headache, your back hurts. And this is typically when people think something is wrong. This is when we go get the massage and go to the chiropractor or go to the doctor and say,
it's already too late.
We say, fix me, fix me. And it's like, ooh, when you understand the second biological law and the law of two phases, it changes everything about the way you relate to your symptoms. You're like, oh, what did I just resolve? Oh, you know what? It was that. That's why I've got this headache. That's why my back hurts. You know, I had a fight with my partner. The shoulders are the relationship self-devaluation. So like your dominant side, that is your partner side. And so like, if you had a fight with your spouse and you were feeling bad or feeling guilty or feeling like you let them down, or if it was with your child, it's your non-dominant side. You feel, you know, guilty about something, you let your child down, and then you resolve it. It's like, ooh, my shoulder really hurts, but I didn't do anything. This is where we think, oh, I must've just slept on it wrong. there's not an obvious physical injury, but some area of your body starts to hurt. But when you say, oh, there's nothing wrong, I resolve something and my body's now in the restoration phase, it changes the way that you relate to your health.
Yeah. I mean, you can be grateful that you have these symptoms, right? And then actually kind of self-reflect on, rather than think like, what did I do wrong? I did something wrong, and this is like the punishment that I have to work through because I did something wrong.
Oh, that's big. That was huge for me. Like very much like punishment for wrongdoing, you know, even like with eating certain foods. A big thing that I thought for many years was that acne and skin issues was dietary, you know? And so I would try to be so perfect with my diet. And I told myself, oh, I can't eat out. Anytime I eat out at a restaurant, I get a breakout because of the bad oils that they use. And it became this self-fulfilling prophecy where I'd eat the food and then I get the punishment. And the punishment was the breakout. But what I learned in GNM, another very common conflict that leads to acne type of issues, is feeling attacked or feeling soiled. And so feeling soiled, when I would eat foods that I'm like, oh, I know this food is naughty, or I shouldn't do this, I felt soiled by the food. And it was the soiling experience that caused the breakout, not the oil. You know, because again, if it was just simply the physical item of the oil, everybody that ate it would have the same exact response. Right. And they don't.
And so have you felt that that shifted once you didn't feel like, oh, now I'm eating dirty oil because I'm out and I'm doing the wrong thing. And so now that you
no
can
problems.
Be the, right.
Totally liberated. Yes, exactly. It's freedom. It's like, oh, I don't even think about it. You know, and I don't really eat out that often anyways. And that's kind of where you start weaving in certain things with lifestyle interventions. Like I still eat super healthy. I still eat super clean. I don't use toxic products. Not because I don't, I prefer not to. I like things mm-hmm. close to nature, but I no longer think that those things harm me in the same way that I once thought.
It's so interesting because I'm looking at the parallels between what you are an expert at and then just sort of like the understanding of vibrational medicine or energy medicine through flower essences. So we would say the body is the screen and then all the energy body part of it that's in and around the body is like the projector. So if you didn't resolve something on a thought or emotional level, it can manifest into the physical plane. But it kind of goes hand in hand. I mean, thinking as you're talking like, oh, there's flower essences, mainly in the stone fruit realm, like nectarine, bonsai, plum, that help us resolve feeling attacked. And so if, I mean, I'm just like so excited about your work. I want to like take every course that you have and connect it to a flower essence, because if we can identify what those conflicts are in those patterns and actually, you know, lean into Mother Nature a little bit for more support to help us work these things out inside of ourselves, we could prevent so many imbalances. So how do you, like, what are some of the other tools, you know, besides flower essences, because I'm really, of course, biased and excited about those, but how do you help people identify? Is it like, what are your symptoms? Okay, that ties back to this conflict. Or is it, what conflict do you relate to and how is that manifesting in your body?
Well, we first go off the symptoms, because the symptoms reveal things that, you know, again, because psychologically you may think you're dealing with one thing, but biologically your body's interpreting it in a different way. And so we look at the symptoms because that tells the story. The symptom tells a story of, when did this conflict begin? When did you resolve it? Because a lot of times what we're dealing with really are hanging healings, which is where you've resolved the conflict, but now you're experiencing the symptoms of healing. The symptoms of healing are either reactivating a new conflict, again, oh no, something's wrong with me. Or, you know, a big thing too, like with acne, I remember always, you know, I'd get a zit or something and then one would show up right next to it. And I'm like, what is, you know, and I would feel cursed, especially in high school. It was just the worst. But it's like, oh, when I like see this acne on my face and I feel ugly, I feel soiled, I don't like the way that I look. And then I start picking at it and messing with it and I feel attacked. And so I'm doing all of this stuff. And it's like, that is how I would be in these endless breakouts, you know? And so in understanding what I'm doing, how I'm reacting to my symptoms, you know, that's why what we, you know, a lot of times what we are dealing with, it's like this ongoing thing where the conflict is being reactivated when you get into healing and you're just not finishing it. You're like, you're ripping off the scab each and every time you reactivate the conflict and the body has to go back through the healing phase. And so we start there and then we look at, you know, what in your life can you relate this to? And a lot of times we have to do digging. You know, I was just talking to someone a little, you know, earlier today. I do offer like a 15-minute phone call if anybody is interested in kind of just chatting briefly about what you've got going on to see if we can, you know, find the GNM perspective of what conflict this is. And, you know, we talked through just a couple of things. And by the end of the 15 minutes, she's like, oh, something else just came to me. And, you know, and that's one big thing is just trusting your intuition to deliver to you. Once you kind of have this framework and you start understanding, it's like your body knows, and ask your body and just quiet your mind and allow whatever kind of memory or thing you need to see to come up. And so by the end of the call, she's like, oh my gosh. And I'm like, oh, that fits, you know? And so we kind of work off of, we look at the symptoms and then we start peeling back layers and looking into kind of different corners of your experience.
And do you find that once you have awareness around it, that sort of liberate some of the conflict in itself, and or like what other types of tools besides just the awareness and acknowledgement of it do you find helpful for helping resolve the conflicts?
Yeah, awareness is kind of the essence of all of my work. It's like you've got to be able to see yourself in the midst of a conflict. You've got to see the stories that are tied to it and the role that you're playing in it and the perceptions that you are layering and the meanings that you're giving to things. And so like through that process, you can make a whole lot of changes. You know, sometimes it's very practical. And this was, you know, Dr. Hammer always would talk about, you know, a practical resolution is going to be the best. You know, if your conflict is due to separating with someone or losing someone, or, you know, getting into a new relationship, some type of practical resolution where you don't have something and then it's like, oh, I get that thing again. And now, oh, that's going to be the easiest way to do it. But sometimes that's not possible. And that's where inner transformation and transmutation. And sometimes you have to, you know, and I kind of go to a spiritual place even, because some things it's like, I'm having difficulty on a practical level resolving this. And it's like, okay, we've got to go a couple levels up and transmute this situation. And so, yeah, my work is just, it's in your relationship to things. In your relationship to how you're seeing yourself and your problems, and even like interventions. And I, you know, currently I don't really recommend things to people because I'm not about things. I'm about your relationship to the things, you know, like, you know, if a person is, and that's where balancing the mainstream or like conventional type of treatments and interventions, it's like, you know, I care most about how you feel about it, you know, because if a person strongly believes, you know, if they're kind of teetering, if they're 51%, they're like, oh, I believe that I need some medication, but I also believe that the body can heal. It's like, we've got to go, we just start with where you are and start with your relationship to it and help you to feel as good as possible about what you're doing, feeling like you're doing the right thing. You know, embedding self-trust is so huge for me, and like trusting yourself to know, is this intervention right for me, or is this therapeutic, or is this, you know, this supportive tool, is this going to help me? It's like, check inside. And that's how, you know, and making yourself your inner guide, your own compass, and being able to hear that. You know, so many people are used to looking outside themselves for answers. Like they want to find a confident person and latch on to that confidence because they have such like a depth of lack of self-trust. And I want to help to fortify that trust and that strength and bring that back to them, because what is that? That's self-devaluation. That's like, who am I to know? You know, neck issues, like intellectual self-devaluation, like feeling stupid, feeling like I'm not smart enough to know. And so many people are doing that right now. They're like, you're not a this, you're not a that, you know, we need to listen to the experts. And it's like, you have an inner voice, like you have access to all of the wisdom in the universe through your own consciousness. And that's what I want you to tap into, is your access to all that is, all of the wisdom. There is no, like, as soon as someone says, I have all the secret wisdom and you need to come through me and you need to do what I say, it's like, whoa, hold the phone. No, that's not how this works. I have access to all the wisdom that you have, and I can check inside and I can know, and it can resonate within me. And that is what needs to be boosted within people, because that is, you know, that self-security, that strength, and all of these things. What is that? That makes you the measure of all things, that makes you the victor instead of the victim. That makes you the being, the organism that cannot be harmed. And that's what I'm interested in helping people tap into. And that's what we need, is we need people to rise up as individuals, as individual consciousness, and say, you know what, I know what's best for me. I am an individual. I don't have to, you know, subjugate myself to the will of the collective. And I think that is huge. And I think the way to help the collective is through the individual. And that's why, you know, my message so much is just that of peace. So regardless, like people are like, well, what do I do? I'm so worried about, you know, mandates and all of this. It's like, hold your ground, be still, find your peace, imagine the future you want to see and place yourself in it. And it's like that power, we just underestimate the power that we have. We underestimate the power of our imagination, the power of staying calm. Like if you realize that your peace and your like balance and being undisturbed by appearances, how powerful that really is. Whew, I mean, people would be like hardcore meditators, hardcore, like, I'm just gonna, you know, sit here and stand my ground peacefully. And that, again, what is that? That is inner balance, and that is inner strength. And that is homeostasis. And that is all as well. That is my organism is getting the message of just, you know, there is nothing to adapt to. All is well. And that's like, that's the where we want our dwelling place to be, is in the sense of deep abiding peace.
And what a relief, because then there's nothing that externally we have to do or mobilize or protest or be on the streets. It's really just coming back to that. How can I hold my ground and be undisturbed inside of myself? It makes it so easy. And then you're not only, I mean, my hunch is based on experience and studies. And if you can do that for yourself, it's not just for you also. There are many, many people that you're connected to that are feeling the benefit of that. And then as everybody sort of pitches in to keep their sense of balance, it creates a ripple effect.
Absolutely. Right? Yeah. It's like an anchor, like this calm. When you're anchored and you kind of share your perspective of being anchored with other people, it's like, whew, I like that. And that's the thing, is like, follow what brings peace. You know, if there is something in the world that's going on, you're like, oh, but it's really scary. But I'm like, is it freaking you out? Is it causing you to be unbalanced? That's not where you want to be putting your attention. And you get to choose where you put your attention. And again, trusting, like, if there are physical actions that need to be taken, your intuition, the universe, will guide you to those physical actions that need to happen. But it's not going to come from a place of, I got to figure this out. I need to learn more. I need to take in more information. I need to find out what I need to do. I need to, you know, mobilize. It's like, do it from a place of peace, and then trust that the answer that you need, if there's an action step, if there's someone you need to connect with, if you need to, you know, move your family out of the city, like this, the answers will come to you when you are calm, when you're receptive.
So if someone were to ask you, what do you recommend to people to dial up the volume on their ability to trust themselves?
Watch your mind, pay attention, awareness, seeing the stories that undermine your trust in yourself, you know, because that's the thing. It's like, there are just conversations happening in your head all day long, constantly. And, you know, you can try to do a couple of things, but when you start seeing, you know, it's kind of like, you know, this devil on your shoulder, this voice in your head that says, who are you to know? You didn't go to school. You're not educated on this. You know, the things that poke holes in this sense of self-trust. It's like, if you talk to yourself like that 24/7 all the time, if your parents talk to you that way and you've been, you know, undermined for forever, you don't know what influence you are under of the reasons you don't trust yourself. And so when you start seeing, oh, that voice is making me feel like garbage. It's making me feel like I'm stupid, and who am I to know? And I need to, you know, listen to the experts because I'm just a mom, or I'm just a this, or I, you know, it's like this little old me syndrome. It's like, that's the thing you need to pay attention to. So if you want to trust yourself, you have to figure out the ways in which your trust in yourself is undermined through these voices that have been implanted in your head. And so it's like, how does that make you feel when you say that to yourself? Do you feel the sense of, you know, like that, you know, that feeling? I mean, everybody knows that feeling of like when you are feeling good about something in your life, and that voice, and that's the thing, is like this voice that's within us, it knows your weakest point. It knows exactly the button. It knows exactly how to decimate your self-esteem. It knows how to say, but they don't know about this. You know, and like, and that's one of the things I do in my work with people, is help them to preempt, knowing that that voice is going to come in, knowing that, you know, oh, we do all this great work together and we start feeling really good and feeling really confident. And it's like this voice comes to poke holes in this, like this bubble of confidence that you're building, but you've got to know it's going to do that and preempt it, and have this kind of mental, you know, have this kind of sacred inner space where you don't let these voices in anymore. And you know how to handle them, and you have kind of a game plan for handling them, is something that I teach people in my work, because it's like, that's what's been necessary for me to stay in my confidence and stand my ground and to trust myself. I have to figure out all the ways in which I undermine that trust.
So I know we didn't get through all of them. I mean, we could probably talk all day, but I know that on your Instagram profile, if you go to your bio link, you have a beautiful video on the 5 laws of biology, as well as some, I saw some other videos on YouTube about the current state of affairs and how Germanic New Medicine plays into that, right? So I would recommend, if people are feeling intrigued, to definitely go and check out those videos. And then also, just before we wrap, I want to mention that you also have the Ever Better Life podcast. You have a club, you have courses. I mean, just if you get a chance, go on her website, because I mean, I just get excited looking at the different conflicts, right? Because it's almost like taking a quiz, right? You're like trying to figure out your own fingerprint and what are the things that take you off your balance and how that ties into the physical symptoms that you experience, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, there's a lot of fun stuff to explore on my YouTube channel. A lot of just tutorials of how the biology works, like the science part. And this is the thing is like understanding will bring you freedom. It's like, I believe that individuals, you don't have to be a doctor to understand how your body works. And I think that the way to empower people is with understanding your physiology. And, you know, you are capable, you are equipped to understand how your body functions. And when you understand the functions of your body, you don't fear them. You know, like when you understand what a tumor means, you know, a tumor, like the word cancer just like incites fear within people. But when you understand what cancer means and you understand what a tumor means, you do not have to fear it. And that's just like, that's freedom. That is freedom through understanding. Freedom through understanding, oh, this is just how my body works. This is just, you know, and so I highly recommend watching those tutorial videos because the more equipped you are in that regard, the next time, you know, some type of health symptom happens, you will feel so much more empowered. And it's so cool to watch your body after you know GNM because it's like, oh, this is so interesting. I'm so fascinated by the fact that I have a UTI or something.
Well, yeah, I mean, it adds this whole other level of cherishing versus like loss of control and something that I don't understand and my body's against me and why am I feeling this again? And I thought I was versus like an instant, ah, compassion.
Yes, that is the feeling. I feel, oh, body, you did this. You built this zit, you know, like a melanoma. You built this for a reason. You did this because I was having an experience and you stepped in to help me. It really is very much a state of compassion.
Wow. So last words of wisdom, something you find yourself commonly telling people these days or something that organically springs to your heart?
All is well. All is well. You know, when you really embrace this, when you really access this universal wisdom and you really see what your consciousness is, you really will see that there's nothing to be afraid of. There's nothing outside of you. There's nothing that can harm you. You are everything and all is within you. Everything is taking place within you. You're projecting this entire experience of life. And the more you go within and the more stillness and balance you find, the more you will be able to see truly how well everything is and how safe you really are.
I love it. Thank you so much for being with us, Melissa.
Thank you. This is awesome.
Thank you so much for listening to The Flower Lounge. I'm Katie Hess, and we'll be releasing a new podcast every Wednesday. If you like what you heard or you know someone who might be touched by our conversation, share it with them. And don't forget to subscribe. To find out what your favorite flowers mean about you, take the quiz at lotusweigh.com.